Hello, everybody, and welcome to episode 16 of the In From Japan podcast. I'm your host, Errol Moss, and as always, with me is my co-host, Jason Corder.
Hey.
And this is the podcast where we talk about the latest news on Japan-developed games and other things in relation to them. Available on Spotify, Podbean, and YouTube. Other podcast services to be determined. So as always, we're going to start with the games we've been playing. And I have still been playing Animal Crossing, but it's more just a daily thing now. Play for an hour and then kind of done, go on to do other stuff.
Yeah.
Because there's no events, the season hasn't really changed, so like the fish and bugs are largely the same, I feel.
I mean, it's still the Earth Day event, right?
Yeah.
But
Leaf was in my town again this morning.
It's a pretty low-key event in comparison to the Easter thing.
Thank God.
And it's probably Nintendo correcting themselves after the backlash from Zipper. His inclusion.
Yeah. I am working on a Power Rangers themed room, so that's cool, I guess.
No, I mean, at this...
I'm not very excited about
it. I mean, at this point, everyone is customizing whatever they have to fit their personality. I'm still on a basic house thing. I'm not really theming it up, because, yeah, I'm still a few weeks behind everyone else, so I'm taking it
in a
measured approach.
I have a living room, a bedroom, a money room.
A money
and
room,
a Power Rangers room.
Wow.
Yeah, a money room. So I so what I did is I made the money floor, which is like 50,000 bells. So you just take 50,000 bells and make a floor out of money. And then I put the bank vault wallpaper and the bell bag rug, and then I and all my gold nuggets are also just in that room because I'm not using them.
You're a regular Scrooge McDuck.
Yeah, that's the theme I was kind of going for that room. But what I have been playing otherwise is I was playing Dragon Quest VIII, making a little more progress, but I kind of got bored of it just because of all the grinding. It's still a great game. It's just like, I'm at a part where you're going from one continent to the other, and you have to cross the ocean, and of course you're going to run into a lot of monsters doing that. And
yeah,
I think I'm a little, one or two of my characters are kind of underleveled, so I just have to grind more in that. So I'm taking a break from that. I did play I know why I played it, but so I played Transformers Devastation. Yes, that does count as a Japanese game because Platinum. It's good.
I mean, Transformers is, in origin, a Japanese product, so it fits.
I don't think Transformers is. I think GoBots was, and I think then Transformers ripped off GoBots, but then Transformers also became popular in Japan, so then Transformers got anime, and now it's kind of just...
I mean, it's kind of different. It started as Diclone and Microman toy line, and that got rebranded in America as Transformers.
And Optimus Prime is Convoy.
Actually, a Japanese franchise before it became Transformers.
Yeah, but so
yeah, something like that.
Because of Transformers in Review, that kind of funny was doing. And our friend Chloe, who is known throughout the kind of funny community as the girl who loves robots. But anyways, so like Transformers 3 was on Hulu and I'd never seen it before. I'd only seen the first two. So I'm like, all right, I'll watch it. And wasn't that bad. Wasn't great. It was entertaining. But then I was like, I had Transformers Devastation on my PlayStation because it was a PlayStation Plus game a while back. And I don't want to delete it because that's one of the games that disappeared from the PSN because of licensing issues. Just like Korra did.
Yeah, but
yeah.
If you wanted to keep it there anyways after I downloaded it, so
like whatever. It was pretty cool. It kind of sucks that they kind of teased for a sequel when that's not going to happen because it was an Activision deal and all that. I think I just wanted to play a stylish action game after all that grinding I was doing in Dragon Quest, and then the and then I guess Final Fantasy VII Remake isn't like that much stylish action because of all the slowdown, like casting spells and all that. So I guess I just felt like it and I didn't even realize it. That's all I've been playing so far. There's also been a lot of sales. That's going to be our main topic later. I'll talk about other games there. But what have you been playing?
I haven't really been playing a lot this week because of regular work stuff. I have, as you mentioned, or as you have done this week too, played a little bit of Animal Crossing. It's a nice break. It's a nice breath of fresh air amidst everything else. And I don't feel the need to stay longer than I need to. So I just do my daily chores. I check in with the villagers. My first villager actually left the island already.
Who? Oh.
Frida,
the
sheep thingy. Frida. Maybe I'll have a screenshot somewhere. I'll show it to you whenever we're done. But she left the island, and I was kind of bummed by that because I wasn't expecting it. And I'm so amazed at how much of an attachment I had to her as a character. There's now an empty plot on my island as a daily reminder of the void she left us with. But yeah, I'm still enjoying that. I've played a little bit of Final Fantasy VII Remake. I'm still chipping away slowly. I'm at chapter 15 now. On my way to the Shinra building. I'm hoping to finish it this weekend. So we'll see.
Yeah.
Oh, and I've also finished the first Zero Escape game, 999. Yeah. A complete playthrough of all the endings. And it was a lot of work. Well, it's a puzzle, so it was really trying to... a lot of Sudoku, a lot of digital roots and timelines and morphogenic fields. But it was an enjoyable ride. I still have some questions at the end of it, but I'm hoping.
Yeah, what I sent you for my friend, I feel like is
fill in some of the
pretty
blanks.
Good. He's read extensively on this kind of stuff. So I asked him, like, when you asked me, I was like, "Hey, you probably know the answer to this better than I do."
Yeah. Probably, yeah. No, I've also done a little bit of research, and I've. I dove into the forums and the wikis, so I knew where he was getting at. I don't totally agree with everything he said, but we'll see. We'll see how it goes in the sequel.
I had to think about 999. Oh, so you played the Nonary Games collection. Did you play it with the voices?
I did. You didn't?
Well, when I played it, it didn't have voices yet, because I played it on iOS.
Oh, it was on DS. Oh, iOS. Yeah. Okay, cool.
So I didn't have to do Sudoku either.
Didn't they cut most of the puzzles out of the iOS version?
Yeah.
So I had the harder time out of the both of us. But I enjoyed it because it reminded me of the Phoenix Wright games and the Layton games. Just a bit tougher and a bit more morbid theme.
Well, it's a happy ending.
But I enjoyed it.
Well,
it is,
for the most part.
The canon ending. The canon ending is more or less a very happy ending.
But so you played with the English voices?
Yeah,
how did you feel about them?
I liked it. Mixed. I'm pretty okay with it. I didn't know what to expect. From the beginning, I had the English voices on. I don't even know if I can change it to Japanese, probably in the settings. But yeah, I don't mind the English voices at all.
I feel like I heard the voices, and I was like, oh, I would have chose these people for this character, but that's a nitpicky thing, obviously. Like, mm-hmm. like, oh, that's not who I would have casted for that character. Whatever. I need to check it again.
I mean, after 23 hours with the cast, I've grown pretty attached to who voices who.
You kind of just got used to it, yeah.
Yeah, I really got used to it. And I mean, some of the things were kind of grating, but that's because Japanese style of storytelling doesn't really always mesh well with Western style of storytelling. So, yeah. It was pretty enjoyable, all in all. I highly recommend it.
Yeah. Is that just Animal Crossing and 999 for the most part? And Final Fantasy VII Remake?
For the most... Yeah.
Alright.
Nothing else.
Alright, so we're going to move on to the next section. We're not going to have an In From Japan J-List this week. I had a thing for it, then I realized it was a Japan-exclusive thing, so I was like, oh, well, I don't... We probably don't need that. So we're going to skip straight to the recommended reading, watching, and listening. Oh, actually, I do have one thing for the End From Japan J-List, actually. Now that okay. I mention it.
Shoot.
It's not video game related, but since I've talked about it on this podcast before. So, Tokushoutsu, the people who brought the first Kamen Rider series over through Pluto TV and Tubi TV. By the time this podcast goes up, no. Not by the time, the same day this podcast goes up. So tomorrow.
Soon-ish?
Or today, whenever you're listening to this. Friday, May 1st at 4 p.m., Kamen Rider Kuga, the first Kamen Rider series of the new millennium, will premiere, the English subtitle, with official English subtitles, will premiere on Pluto TV at 4 p.m. Pacific Standard Time.
Okay.
And then it will be, the whole series should be available on Tubi TV by that time as well.
Okay, that's cool.
So that was just a quick thing. It's kind of funny, they went from the first, the very first, all the way to that one. But maybe that's just the only other one they have the rights for right now.
Probably. Are you looking forward to it?
Yeah, I'm going to try to watch it when it airs.
Okay. Let us know how that goes.
Also, the Toei Tokusatsu channel is still going strong. They put, like, a really old Sentai series on there, but then, of course, they accidentally copyright struck themselves again. So that's not on there anymore. But they have the Shin Kamen Rider movie, which is kind of like a more adult take on Kamen Rider from the early 90s. So, you know, when superheroes were all getting all the edgy kind of dark stuff. I've been meaning to watch that, too. That's also subtitled. And they have just a bunch of old random tokusatsu shows. Anyways, moving on to the recommended reading, watching, and listening list. And we got some good stuff this week. So we have Final Fantasy VII Remake has big Yakuza energy and it's wonderful by our friend Michael Hyam over at GameSpot. Majora's Mask still hits hard 20 years later by Heather Alexandra at Kotaku. The Legend of Zelda Breath of the Wild 2 needs to be as weird as Majora's Mask by Nadia Oxford, US Gamer. Why a massive fan Pokemon tournament could change competitive Pokemon forever by Ben Sledge, Eurogamer. Final Fantasy III designer wasn't particularly into Moogles, actually, by Ian Walker, Kotaku. Are there a lot of Moogles in Final Fantasy III or something?
If I'm not mistaken, Final Fantasy III is the first instance of the Moogles in the series.
I see. Please Stop Turning Anime into Arena Fighter Games by Tamor Hussein over at GameSpot. It's a great article, and...
Yeah, and he also really loves Rise of a Ninja, the Naruto game by Ubisoft. So it's.
I heavily agree. Sorry, my audio did that thing again, so I had to repeat myself.
No, it's fine. You're on Trials of Mana.
Yeah. Trials of Mana and Final Fantasy VII's fine remakes also show us what's been lost along the way by Martin Robinson at Eurogamer. Adventure, humor, and humanity's utter end. The enduring appeal of Mega Man Legends 2 by Nadia Oxford, US Gamer. And then, Boss Fight Books, their fifth set of books, including books on Resident Evil and Silent Hill 2, are on Kickstarter. And, if you haven't read a boss fight book before, they each have, like, a writer write a lot about, like, one game and a bunch of background. The two I've recommended here are the two I've read, which is Kingdom Hearts 2 by Alexa Ray Correia, which I own. And, unfortunately, somehow I've never gotten... Mm-hmm. So, I've tried to get this book signed several times.
Which one?
The one time I finally met her, like, either had the book and didn't get the chance to meet her... Or I, and then when I finally met her, I didn't have the book.
Oh, bummer.
And she was like, oh, it's fine. You'll probably see me on another thing. And then, of course, all this happened. So who knows if that will be when that'll be. And maybe we can get her on sometime. Who knows?
Oh, that would be cool.
And the other one is Final Fantasy V by Chris Kohler. That one's really interesting because it's all about like fan translation and how people played Final Fantasy V before it was localized for the...
Yeah, because
Game Boy Advance?
Final Fantasy V never made its way to the US, if I'm not mistaken. Or at least the PlayStation 1 version, and then the Game Boy Advance versions.
Yeah, something like that. And then, I don't think it's out yet. It's going to be out next month, but Reggie Fils-Aimé, he is doing a new gaming podcast for charity. It's called... What is it called? Talking Games with Reggie and Harold. Alongside award-winning author / journalist Harold Goldberg. The podcast is helping to raise money for the New York Video Games Critics Circle nonprofit's mentoring work in the time of COVID-19. And they have a GoFundMe page, and I'll just link it in the description. And one of the first guests will be Jeff Keighley himself.
Oh... That's so look out for that. That's a lot of experience in one podcast.
Yeah, all our heads are going to collectively explode from listening to it.
Probably. Okay.
All right, so now it's time for the news rundown. And the nice thing is, I mean, while there is bad news, it's not quite as intense. It's kind of like expected bad news. None of it is like, oh, this person got sick or this person died. It's kind of like, oh, okay. Like, this stuff will happen eventually, or whatever. So go ahead, bearer of bad news. And yeah, I did. Did you notice I put a sound effect in the last one?
Yeah, I did. So I'm hoping.
Good.
I'm hoping we could one day get Shinigami sound effect.
What's a Shinigami? How would you get a from like Death Note or?
Well. I'll just have to weigh it against each other, like the Death Note one and the Bleach one. And maybe we can pick one someday soon. We'll think about it. Okay, and on to the baddish news. First up is Nintendo confirms up to 160,000 accounts accessed in huge privacy breach. This is an article by Tom Phillips for Eurogamer. And at the top there's an update saying currently no evidence pointing towards a breach of Nintendo databases, servers, or services. So did something happen or not? Anyway, let's see. Should I do the original story or the updated one?
Probably the updated one, right?
Okay, I'll do the updated one. Nintendo has now published an English language statement on today's announcement. Its account system has suffered a privacy breach affecting up to 160,000 people. In a statement, Nintendo says that at present there was no evidence to suggest Nintendo's own databases, servers or services have been accessed. This again suggests the login data used to access accounts was obtained elsewhere, a tactic known as credential stuffing. To protect accounts going forward, Nintendo will not detail more of how the attack took place. I'm sorry. Finally, as we reported earlier, login via Nintendo Network ID has been disabled and all users are highly recommended to enable two-factor authentication immediately. The article includes a full statement by Nintendo and the original story, should you be so interested to read. Okay, have you seen anything fishy on your Nintendo account?
Have I what?
Seen anything fishy?
No. Besides, somebody keeps buying games. I don't know why. I don't know who. It's probably me.
that darn Errol. Anyway, Monster Hunter World Iceborne expansion title update 4 delayed by Sal Romano for Gamatsu. Capcom has delayed Monster Hunter World Iceborne title update 4. That's a mouthful. From its previously planned May release to an unannounced date. And there's a full statement by Capcom in the article, so give it a click and see for yourself. Let's see. I don't see a specific date. No.
For
probably
what?
Not. Oh, there's a revised revised roadmap for the update. Like April 10 to May 7.
Yeah, I actually just bought.
Yeah, so it should be somewhere in April. Mm-hmm.
I actually just got Iceborne since it was on sale and I had been waiting to get it anyway.
Oh.
I haven't played it again yet because I was like, I was still at the like
very beginning.
The starting. I was pretty early on, yeah.
Oh, okay.
In Monster Hunter World. And I asked my friend, who is a big Monster Hunter fan.
Mm-hmm.
Same one who's the 999 fan. And he was, and I was asking him, because he didn't like it at Monster Hunter World at first either. And then I was asking him before I got it, I'm like, how do you think it is now compared to back then? And he's like, oh, it's improved a lot. And like all my problems with it are pretty much gone. And I was like, all right.
Well, according to the roadmap, the newest title update is TBD, so hang on to your butts.
Also, I forgot a recommended reading, watching, and listening thing. I forgot one, and I can't believe I forgot it.
Do you want to do it now?
Yeah, Animal Talking. Animal Talking by Gary Whitta is Gary Whitta's talk show that takes place in Animal Crossing.
Which is a very novel concept.
And he's trying to get Danny Trejo on now, because apparently Danny Trejo plays Animal Crossing.
Which is the greatest thing ever.
Yeah.
Okay, moving on. Back to bad news. Some Final Fantasy VII Remake Orchestra World Tour shows delayed until 2021 by Jenny Lada for Silicon Era. The Final Fantasy VII Remake concert event won't be moving forward as planned. The COVID-19 coronavirus has pushed back a series of shows in the name of public safety. Square Enix announced that the Final Fantasy VII Remake Orchestra World Tour will now have three of its shows running in 2021 rather than 2020. The article has a bit more, so you can click on that if you so choose. Next up, yeah. Rumor.
Oh, wait. I had a thing to say about that.
Okay, go ahead.
That's kind of weird. Mm-hmm. So do you see how, like, one of the... So it says multiple shows still in place, with the earliest one being San Francisco, California's July 9th, 2020 show. How come that one hasn't been delayed? That's really weird.
That is a good question. I have no idea.
I think maybe they just haven't... I feel like there will be an update where they... Maybe they just haven't had, like, decided a date to move that one to yet.
That's probably so.
Because you have to go with the city's, like, policy and, yeah, and their, whatever their stay-at-home policy is or will be and whatever their timeline is. And you have to...
And
different countries, too. And
I imagine with an orchestra performing, you'd have people very close to each other, and that would not be adhering to social distancing guidelines. Yeah.
Yeah, so I just found it weird that I'm like, how come that one wasn't delayed?
Yeah. Hopefully there'll be an update soon.
Yeah.
All right.
I would like to go to that if I can in the future. Because I've never been to a video game orchestra, and I always miss the Kingdom Hearts one.
I'd really want to go to Distant Worlds. The one on the Final Fantasy series.
Oh, the whole Final? Oh, yeah. That'd be a good one, too.
Yeah. I think all four volumes are on Spotify now, so if you want to have a taste of that, you can check it out there.
I think most Final Fantasy music is on Spotify, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah.
Except for Remake. That's like the only one that's not on there yet.
Not yet. Okay. Rumor. Nintendo will not host a Nintendo Direct in June. By Sal Romano for Gamatsu. Nintendo will not host a Nintendo Direct event in June, according to a VentureBeat report. While the company initially planned to host a Nintendo Direct in June to correspond with E3 2020, it is reportedly telling partner developers plans are off this year due to complications brought about from Japan's work-from-home order in response to the ongoing COVID-19 pandemic. And later on, there's an update. According to Eurogamer's own sources, Nintendo has told publishers set to reveal games during its showcase that it needs more development time on its first-party games as the company adapts to a work-from-home environment. Publishers have reportedly been told not to wait if they would like to make their own announcements individually. So that's kind of a bummer, but understandable given the circumstances.
Yeah, so I was listening to Kind of Funny today, and they were like, yeah, like it's weird not them not having any kind of lineup still and doing this. And I'm like, people, there are things coming out just because it's not first party. And also, like, they could do the Twitter stuff. Like, they can announce stuff whenever, have their own specific. Like, if that Mario stuff is true, I would expect them to have a Mario Direct specifically.
Yeah, but...
It's very...
But I'm guessing...
It's
yeah, go ahead.
Just because there's not going to be a Nintendo Direct doesn't mean there won't be anything in June from them.
No, that's true. They said that the first-party development still needs a bit more time, so I'm guessing even the Mario announcements need a bit more time in the oven.
Probably. Deadly Premonition 2 is Switch exclusive, right?
Yeah, but that would be third-party.
We're going to talk about that later because of the release date, but it's almost like people for, I guess it's niche, but
it is niche. It's like, and it's third party,
but people were acting like Nintendo had nothing for the summer, and I'm like, that's not true at all.
No, but I think they mean Nintendo as a first party. Yeah, because
okay,
that's the thing that drives sales. It's exclusives, not just third party endeavors, and people are really attached to Nintendo's properties. And them not having had any of the plans shown in the early months kind of made everyone focus on June for them revealing their big plans, so it not happening anymore, it's kind of a bummer.
Yeah. There is going to probably be still a Smash Direct with whatever ARMS character.
Sure, but that's also taking a bit more time, as Sakurai has said in his Famitsu column. Alright, next up. The Wonderful 101 Remastered's physical release delayed due to coronavirus. This is by Matt Wales for Eurogamer. Platinum Games has delayed the physical release of its spruced-up superhero action romp, The Wonderful 101 Remastered, due to shipping and distribution issues relating to the coronavirus. The digital release will, however, still go ahead as originally planned. I think we're going to see a lot of this moving forward. Things announced and still on their way this year. We'll probably have physical delays to physical media or physical copies, or you'll have a limited supply of physical copies in stores or able to be shipped worldwide. worldwide. So yeah. I'm kind of glad I did not kickstart or back that option. But yeah,
I mean, it's not their fault.
The digital is still coming out. No, it's not their fault. Not at all.
Yeah.
But yeah, I'd be bummed. Anyway, next up, GDC Summer is going fully digital. This is a staff post on the official GDC website.
Okay. I'm disappointed, but I'm not surprised.
I mean, there's nothing much else they can do at this point.
Yeah.
Unless you want to attend in a hazmat suit.
No.
Okay, well, there you have it. Anyway, the statement reads as, "We have been continuously reviewing the best ways to serve the game development community over the past few months as the world has continued to adapt to developments. While we were very much looking forward to meeting again in person as soon as possible, we are moving forward with a plan to transform GDC Summer into an all-digital event in order to best serve our community. As so many game developers embrace remote working arrangements and online collaboration, we're inspired to adapt and deliver GDC in a digital format that will be available to everyone with an internet connection, and will work hard to deliver the high-quality content and networking opportunities GDC attendees have come to expect. We believe in the power of gathering our community to share, inspire, and strengthen our industry, and are committed to providing that opportunity in August. We look forward to sharing more information about GDC Summer soon." Okay, that's the bad news out of the way. So, take it away.
Yeah, and it wasn't that bad. It's kind of like stuff that's kind of expected.
At this point, with everyone adhering to social distancing and more...
Well, unfortunately, with not everyone adhering to social distancing.
Well, I mean, in general. that and better hygiene. We're looking forward to flattening the curve as soon as possible. And people are adapting to new ways and digital formats to bring the content we have grown accustomed to. So...
yeah,
it's not how we want to enjoy the stuff we enjoy, but it's still something instead of nothing.
It's what we can do for now.
Yeah.
Remember, even though this will take a while to get a vaccine and stuff, this is still just temporary.
Yeah.
It's just a very long temporary.
Yeah, exactly.
So, this next story. Free Pac-Man Championship Edition 2 is part of Bandai Namco's Stay at Home initiative by Denny Latta at Silicon Era. So, they decided that you can get Pac-Man Championship Edition 2 for free on PC, Xbox, and PlayStation 4. Oh, I thought Switch too. Oh, no, I don't think it's on Switch. I think only the first one's on Switch.
No, it's not on Switch.
It says, copies are available to claim until May 10th.
I
need to download that.
Did you claim one, or did you?
I need to.
Okay. I'm wondering, should I? It's free, but...
It's one of those things where I might as well. That's what I've been doing with all the, like, free Steam games, like Tomb Raider and all that other stuff. I'm like, well, if it's free and I've never played it and I've heard decent things about it, so I might as well.
Oh, the first Tomb Raider is pretty great. That's my opinion. Okay, next up, we have Final Fantasy XII PS4 PC Edition patch adds Zodiac Age features, reportedly breaks PC... Okay, this is a very weird headline. I'm sorry, Dual Shockers. This is by Scott White for Dual Shockers. So what the headline is trying to communicate is that Final Fantasy XII, the Zodiac Age Remastered Edition, got an update for PS4 and PC, which brings it in line with the Xbox One and Switch version, I'm guessing, if I'm not totally mistaken. And that brings the job resets, the 3 times or the 3 gambit sets you can create, and some of the other handy updates that were in the Switch and Xbox version. But the article reads, this morning out of the blue, Square released patches for both the Final Fantasy 12 Zodiac Age for PlayStation 4 and PC, which adds features that were unique to Switch and Xbox One ports. Unfortunately, it also breaks the PC version, so buyer beware. Released at the end of April last year, the Switch and Xbox versions of the enhanced FF12 remaster known as the Zodiac Age added features that weren't present in the first PC or PS4 releases. These included a job reset feature that allows players to respec their characters and the ability to save three sets of gambits with which players could swap between, allowing for many more options in how your party of heroes behaves. They were exciting features and ones that the players on PC and PS4 wanted too. So this is a great, great update, barring the PC issues. But these little things is what made me choose the Switch version over the PS4 version. Like, I really wanted the trophies for this game, but it not having the ability to respec or have additional gambits was a deal breaker. So I'm happy that people who invested in the PS4 or PC version are also getting some love. Okay. Next up. Something I'm very, very excited about. Tales of Crestoria release date updated to early June 2020 by Jenny Lada for Silicon Era. There is a Tales of Crestoria release date update, though there are no confirmed or solid dates yet. Tomomi Tagawa, the producer, took to the official Twitter account to provide a statement with a timeline. On April 26, 2020, the Tales of Crestoria theme song and a new video will be released, or have been released. In early May 2020, the closed beta test will be held worldwide. Finally, in early June 2020, the game will launch in every region. However, the statement did say that the COVID-19 coronavirus pandemic could cause these estimates to change. You can read the article for the full statement, but I am super glad that we are getting a new Tales game.
Do you think also we'll hear about Tales of Arise soon? Yeah.
I think closer to June, maybe. It's possible that Bandai Namco will have their own event, or be hosted via IGN, GameSpot, or GamesRadar.
Or so. the Xbox thing we'll talk about later, because it was originally revealed.
That is true.
The Xbox thing. That was the craziest Xbox, Microsoft Xbox one, because they had so many Japanese third-party games that they...
It felt like them going back to the 360 days.
Yeah.
Yeah. But I'm super excited for this because it's a new Tales game. It looks fun. It also adds heroes from older Tales games. So it's kind of like a
Velvet?
Tales of...
I don't know.
All-Stars? Yeah?
Tales of All-Stars.
Tales of All-Stars?
Or what's the one? Tales Versus?
Is yeah.
The fighting game that we never got?
There was also that. And there was also a crossover game on PSP, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, that's what Tales Versus is, I thought.
There's another one. I think it was Tales Versus the World, if I'm not mistaken.
Oh, let me look yeah.
it up real quick.
I think you're right.
Tales series. Let's see. Spin-offs. Let's see. Tales Versus. No, that's not the one I want. Tales of the World, Radiant Mythology. That was released in the West, and that was for... It's not saying. See, Tales of the World was released on PSP, and it did make its way to the West. Mm. Tales of Versus did not make its way to the West.
Tales of Symphonia 2. No, we don't talk about that one.
No, please don't. No, that hurts too much.
I was gonna say, and then there was also that time Lloyd Irving was in that one Soul Calibur game. Weirdly.
I mean, it's a Bandai Namco thing.
That's true. Yeah. I just mean graphically speaking, art style wise.
It didn't make sense.
It's really weird.
Okay. The next one is yours.
Oh yeah. So, this comes from Silicon Era and is by Jenny Lotto once again. You choose which Xenoblade soundtrack. Wait, whoops. I messed up the title. You choose which Xenoblade Chronicles definitive soundtrack the game uses. So, the Nintendo of Europe Twitter account shared a sample of a song from Definitive Edition soundtrack. People were able to hear what the remastered version of Colony 9 Shulk's hometown theme song sounded like. Now the Nintendo of Australia Twitter account did the same while dropping some knowledge. People can choose which soundtrack the game uses. The audio clip is otherwise the same in the tweet. It's the context that changes. After sharing the 30-second sample, Nintendo noted that people can go either with either soundtrack when a person picks up Xenoblade Chronicles Definitive Edition and begins playing. You just head into the options and switch between. I'd love when games have that option.
Switching soundtracks?
Just because sometimes, like for example, Final Fantasy VII Remake, I think is great, but I know there are some people who don't like the ways they remixed or remade some of the songs. And that's just with any like remake or update when it has redone mm-hmm. soundtrack.
I have a question regarding that. Which remixes are they having issue with? Because there are two sets. There are like the novelty songs you can collect.
I don't know the specifics.
Oh,
I think it was more the. I don't know. There was something specific about it.
Like, there's a game score, and there's the songs you collect along
I don't know what it was specifically. It didn't seem to... I just assumed it was something about the game score, which mm-hmm. I'm like, okay, I don't know. It sounds great to me.
Yeah, like, the game score is great, but the songs you collect are kind of hit or miss.
Hey, I'm just happy Costa del Sol was in it.
Yeah. Okay, next up is... Xenoblade Chronicles Definitive Edition will have a new battle system in its additional scenario by Sato for Silicon Era. Xenoblade Chronicles Definitive Edition will release later next month, but we learned that its additional scenario, Future Connected, will have a new battle system. This was originally reported by Gamatsu. The information comes from download cards that are now available for purchase in Japan. The download card has a bit on Xenoblade Chronicles Definitive Edition's additional scenario, Future Connected, which reveals Melia's afterstory. In addition to a new map, parentheses maps, it will also feature a new battle system that uses no pawns reinforcements. Other than that, it doesn't go into too much detail, but we can expect to hear more about it before the game's release next month. So, I'm hoping Eface is pretty stoked about this.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Because he's our resident Xenoblade stan.
I'm sure he's really feeling it.
Yeah. Are you feeling it? Are you interested in this game?
I mean, I did pre-order
Oh, yeah, that is true.
Collector's Edition with the art book. Because I was like, it might be the last physical game for a while. And then, of course, Sony comes out and is like, oh, hey, Last of Us 2, we're going to have a physical release. So, okay, I guess it's not. It may be the last physical Nintendo first party release for a while, though.
Probably.
Plus, I like art books. Next story. This is from Sal Romano over at Gamatsu. Ninjala details seasonal updates, season pass, and character power-ups. Unfortunately, did not get to try the Ninjala beta, even though I have it on my Switch. It's just the times were kind of weird. But Gung Ho Online Entertainment has released the third developer diary for Ninjala, which discusses the game's seasonal updates, season pass, and character power-ups. So it'll have regular seasonal updates, with each season lasting around 8 to 10 weeks. Each will add new features, such as new weapons, stages, and game functions. Ninjala Pass is like a season pass, with a tier system that goes from 1 to 100, and you can receive various rewards by accomplishing missions tied to specific tiers. Character power-ups, passive skills, or you can equip special passive skill, or gum bottles, because there are ninjas that chew gum. You will need a shinobi card and ninja medals, which you can obtain. This is just giving me, like, weird Naruto flashbacks. which you can obtain by participating in online matches, then use them to build up your character as you like. They're just saying, like, different effects. Ninja medals can be used to unlock and enable assist codes. There are also assist codes that further power up shinobi cards. Due out for Switch via the eShop on May 27th in the West and May 28th in Japan. An open beta test will take place on April... which already happened. Currently available. Okay. And then the next story has to do with that. Sonic the Hedgehog might be teaming up with Ninjala. And this is from Nintendo Life by Liam Doolin. Somebody data mined it, which suggests Sonic may have a collaboration with the upcoming title Ninjala in a form of various cosmetic items and stickers. Gotta ninja fast. Seems like some kind of gacha element.
Tagline, but okay. I mean, it's a free-to-play game, so it's bound to be a gacha element.
Yeah. They're not like paid gacha elements. It's just like there seem to be some gacha elements, possibly.
Okay. Oops. Next up is E's Memories of Calcetta.
I think it's Calcetta. Yeah.
Calcetta. For PS4 launches June 9th in North America, June 19th in Europe. This is by Sal Romano for Gamatsu. The PlayStation 4 version of Ys Memories of Calcetta will launch on June 9th in North America and June 19th in Europe. Publishers Exceed Games and Marvelous Europe announced. In North America, Ys Memories of Calcetta will be available in a physical Timeless Adventurer Edition for $39.99, which is not a bad price, at select retailers. It includes a special soundtrack CD that was part of the Ys 25th anniversary pack in Japan and 12 4x6 inches art cards highlighting various heroines from Ys lore. Pre-orders are available now. I mean... Given what you're getting with this physical edition, I say it's really worth the price. It's also a pretty much beloved entry in the Ys series. And yeah.
I haven't played that one, but maybe
I haven't either, but it looks very colorful and flashy, and it's an action RPG, so it's kind of in my wheelhouse.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
We didn't even select who we were going to do the... Yeah, we don't know who does what.
Do you want me to do all of them?
You can do the those three, and then I can do the Bit Summit one.
Okay, cool. Okay. Games Radar announces future game show digital showcase for early June by Sal Romano for Gamatsu. Games Radar has announced Future Game Show, an hour-long digital showcase of some of the most exciting games of 2020 and beyond, that will broadcast during the former week of E3 2020, which would have run from June 9th to 11th. According to Games Radar, the broadcast will contain exclusive trailers, announcements, and deep dives on existing AAA and indie games, focusing on current and next-gen consoles, mobile, and streaming platforms. And be supported by exclusive news, previews, and interviews. More details will be shared in the coming weeks. Future game show will broadcast worldwide on GamesRadar, as well as YouTube, Twitch, Twitter, and more. It will also be promoted across other future network sites such as PC Gamer, Tech Radar, T3, and Tom's Guide. Okay, that was a lot, but cool. Kind of surprising that GamesRadar picked up the slack after IGN and GameSpot.
GamesRadar was announced right before the GameSpot one.
No, I know. But I'm more surprised by the news that it's Games Radar and not someone like Games Informer.
Yeah.
Because Game Informer.
Yeah.
Because I don't know, those are the bigger names. Not discounting Games Radar and the fine work they do, but
no.
No. It's kind of surprising.
But it's not one you'd expect to do something like
yeah,
that.
Yeah, it's a good surprise. It's a welcome surprise. And with IGN, yeah. GameSpot, and them all having exclusives, I'm guessing there will be a lot of new games for the next gen and to round off the current gen.
I'm wondering if Kinda Funny is going to announce a game showcase for them, too. Or not.
Probably, but then it will again be indie focused, more or less, or more likely.
Well, remember, they did announce. Didn't they have Yakuza. One of the Yakuza games revealed there? Or Judgment?
It was Judgment. That is true. Yeah, yeah. Oh well, we'll see. Okay.
So, like.
Mm hmm.
Yeah, it will still probably be mostly indies, but yeah, one or two could be still big.
Yeah. Okay, next up is... Oh, wait a minute.
PC Gaming.
No, it's not PC Gaming. PC Gaming? I don't know why this keeps happening to me, because whenever I look at the dock...
Do they keep switching
around? They keep switching around.
That's really weird. I didn't do anything. I swear.
Or the dock is haunted. Anyway, PC Gaming Show 2020 set for June 6th. By Sal Romano for Gematsu. PC Gamer will host its annual PC Gaming Show this year on June 6th, the outlet announced. The showcase will feature new games never before seen gameplay footage and announcements from some of PC Gaming's biggest and most interesting developers. According to PC Gamer, it will broadcast alongside other gaming presentations as part of a larger day of programming on Twitch and other platforms. Okay, this is really cool too. I mean, I also game on the PC. It's not a great PC, but I also game on the PC, so it's a good thing that the PC gaming crowd are also being catered to in these trying times.
Yeah, my gaming laptop was one of the best investments I've ever made. That's what I'm recording on right now, except for it has some problems with that specifically. But otherwise...
Yeah. Okay. Next up is... Let's see. Okay. Introducing Play for All, GameSpot's summer gaming celebration and charity effort. By Tamur Hussein on GameSpot. For fans of video games, June is one of the most exciting times of the year. Over a week, we as a community come together and watch as the future of gaming is laid out before our eyes. We're regaled with exciting new game announcements, get hands-on with interesting titles that are on the horizon, and hear from developers and executives about their visions. More importantly, we share all that passion and excitement with each other. This year, however, things are a bit different. We don't need to tell you how, you know that well enough at this point. But what we can say is that we at GameSpot don't want to lose that energizing sense of excitement for gaming that we're also used to having around E3. We look forward to it every year, and as we know you do too. Okay, where's the actual announcement? Because I don't want to read
everything. It was pretty cool going to E3 last year, and because IGN didn't have a booth, GameSpot had a stage on the show floor like they usually did, and I got to actually take a picture on it, so that was really cool. But also they had like a bigger stage outside, where they did like where Kinda Funny did stuff, and well, they usually do stuff every year, but like they had like tournaments and stuff. It was just cool to see GameSpot kind of take over E3 when IGN was still there. They just didn't have a booth like usual.
Yeah, that's true. Okay, Tamur, I love you. I love GameSpot, but I'm kind of cutting stuff out so we can be as brief as possible. Beginning in early June and spanning several weeks, Play for All will be the premier destination for gamers worldwide to get up-to-date information on the most exciting announcements. We're partnering with major video game publishers, including Bethesda, CD Projekt Red, Deep Silver, Devolver Digital, Larian Studios, Google Stadia, Bandai Namco, Private Division, Square Enix, Sega, and 2K Games, among many others, to bring you the latest and greatest in gaming. On top of that, we're teaming up with Direct Relief, a humanitarian aid organization whose mission is to improve the health and lives of the world's most vulnerable, and at-risk populations, many of which are affected by poverty and emergencies. Okay, that was a lot. You can read the full article for everyone that will be joining in on Play for All, which is a very good effort, and I applaud GameSpot for doing this.
I'm thinking this is going to make for all these events, it's going to make coverage for each site a lot easier for the stuff that...
Yeah, because it's so contained.
Their thing.
Yeah.
It's like right there already, so they'll have the press release and already have it ready to go.
I mean, GameSpot, if...
Like, for... Right when it's announced, rather than just a couple minutes later.
I was going to say, hey, GameSpot, if you need extra hands, me and Errol are pretty free. I mean...
They don't... I can't, because I'm in California, they don't... Because of the AB5, they're not taking any freelancers from California
now. We'll do it under a pseudonym.
Well, you can do it. I'm not going to stop you.
Fine. Okay, next up is all you.
Yeah, so Bit Summit Gaiden is the online only return of Bit Summit. So the pandemic taking a heavy toll on events of all kinds, and Bit Summit 2020 was among the casualties. But you can't keep a good con down, and the premier Japan-based event for indie gaming is back as Bit Summit Gaiden. In an announcement on the Bit Summit official page Twitter account, Bit Summit Parent Association, Japan Independent Games Aggregate, explained the need for an event that shines light on hardworking indie developers, provides a unique platform to showcase their works, and gives their games the visibility we believe they deserve. And so Bit Summit Gaiden will be held between June 27th and 28th, 2020. Bit Summit is Japan's largest independent games festival, growing since 2012. The yearly event attracted thousands of attendees to see new indie games, alongside support from major Japanese and international publishers. The original Bit Summit 2020 was scheduled for May 9th and 10th, 2020 in Kyoto, Japan, but Bit Summit Gaiden will happen entirely online. Live streaming will take place via official Twitch channels alongside other streaming partners and platforms. So this is kind of awesome, though.
Mm-hmm.
Because a lot of people who wouldn't be able to attend will be able to see it now.
I've never seen a Bit Summit event. So, this will be new.
Well, now you can.
Now I can. I mean, I hope that my schedule allows it. But yeah, I'm looking forward to seeing it.
Next story. This is a me story, 100%.
It's a definitely you story.
Monster Rancher for Switch, iOS, and Android updated with new monsters, player participatory tournament mode, and more from Sawamano and Komatsu. New monsters derived from existing monster species. Still no localization announcement as of yet. Koei Tecmo has released a free update for Monster Rancher, also known as Monster Farm, in Japan, for Switch, iOS, and Android in Japan, which adds new monsters, the player participatory tournament mode, and more. Here are the details. Save slot added. In addition to the two free save slots, you can purchase up to 12 additional save slots for 120 yen each, or the full 12 pack for 980 yen. Battle mode, one player entry method changed. While you were previously only able to select your own monster, you can now select from monsters uploaded by other players, making battles and tournaments between players easier. Player participatory tournament will be held in the future. Players will be able to participate by simply registering a monster that meet the tournament's conditions, and battles will play out automatically without instruction from breeders. Music data added. Added music data for CD titles released between September 29, 2019 and February 1, 2020, and for Switch physical edition titles released between September 2019 and January 2020.
The latter data is exclusively for the Switch version. New monsters added. They don't specify the monsters. Added ability total display, other subtle changes, and bug fixes. This is cool, because it's a lot of new stuff for a re-release.
Mm-hmm.
It's a very enhanced port.
Are you going to be playing it?
If it comes out, that's one of the ones that I haven't played the first Monster Rancher, so if it comes out in English, yes, definitely.
Okay.
But knowing that it's getting this much support, I have hope that maybe it will get localized at some point.
Hopefully. I mean, if anything, just for how much you love it, I just want you to see it and experience it.
Yeah. Like, the save slots being paid, the extra save slots being you have to pay for, that's not great, but mm-hmm. since it's, I can understand because of the fact that it's on mobile. Like, it's on Switch and mobile, so.
I mean, Switch and mobile have plenty of save space. I mean, I'm happy it's making its way to these platforms, but that's a bum excuse.
Yeah. Next story. Official PlayStation Magazine will reveal PlayStation 5 games in this July issue on sale July 2nd. Oh, my birthday.
Hey, real quick. Did you see...
Or June 2nd.
Did you see the thing I already tweeted on DualShockers by Mike Williams for US Gamer?
What was
DualShockers tweeting out May 7th.
Oh, right. Yeah.
That was so great.
The Xbox reveals third-party PS5 games.
I mean, technically, they're not wrong.
I mean, they're not wrong, no. But that was just so...
Yeah. That was great.
Anyways, it's on June 2nd, not July 2nd, which is also my birthday, coincidentally.
Wait, June or July? You have to specify for the listeners.
June 2nd. June 2nd.
Okay.
June 2nd is my birthday. Actually, July 2nd was supposed to be my birthday, but I came out early.
Oh, you couldn't wait.
No, I couldn't. what games came out in 1993, in the summer of 1993, that I was like, oh my god.
I have no idea. I'll look it up real quick. Keep reading.
Yoshi's Island? I don't know. Official PlayStation Magazine may have just given us a better timeline for when we can expect to see Sony reveal the PlayStation 5 in its entirety. In its June issue, available now digitally, on sale physically early next month, it confirmed that the July issue would reveal the latest games coming to PlayStation 5 and how they'll play. It'll go on sale physically June 2nd, but will be available digitally shortly before that, more or less confirming the speculation that Sony is getting ready for a PS5 reveal sometime in May. Yeah.
Okay, so...
And then... There... Just to... There is going to be a... There's supposedly... Mm-hmm. And I'm getting ahead here, but according to Jason Schreier of... What is he writing for now?
He's going to be for Bloomberg Tech.
Oh, yeah. So, formerly of Kotaku, he claimed on Twitter that the PlayStation 5 reveal is probably a few weeks away.
Yeah. So it makes sense.
So that would line up with that, yeah.
And just so since I'm already getting ahead of myself, I might as well just say the Xbox Series X first look is next Thursday, May 7th, yes, at 10 a.m. Pacific Standard Time. So we'll probably be talking about that next week.
Okay. So
depending on what's revealed.
I just looked it up, and if you were born on July, your game would be Samurai Showdown.
Never played it.
You've never played it?
Nope.
Wow. Such a good...
I'm not a fighting game. That's a fighting game, right? I'm not a fighting game person.
Okay, wait. It gets better. Since you're in June, you have Maniac Mansion 2, Day of the Tentacle, The Legend of Zelda, Link's Awakening, and Syndicate. So...
I don't like any of those games.
You're lying. You have to at least like Legend of Zelda.
I like Zelda. I'm not a big Link's Awakening fan. I'm more of an Oracle.
Oh, wow. Person. Did you play Link's Awakening on Switch?
I got to try the demo at E3 and it was fine, mm-hmm. but I didn't have the like connection to it, and I was just like, I just wish it was Oracle.
Well, you're not alone.
I tried playing Link's Awakening on 3DS, and there was that whole trading quest, and I didn't like that.
Okay. Okay. Next up, in some kind of bad news for my country and related territories, the Nintendo 3DS and Wii U eShops closing on July 31st, 2020 in some Caribbean and Latin America countries by Jenny Latta for Silicon Era. A few Nintendo 3DS eShops and Nintendo Wii U eShops will be closing this summer. Specifically, Nintendo announced that some Caribbean and Latin American countries that do not have full eShops for these systems will lose access to the online storefronts on July 31st, 2020. Both Mexico and Brazil will be exempt from these closures as each country has full eShops for both systems. And if you read the article, there's a full list of the countries that will be affected, and I will be affected. Not too much since I don't have a 3DS or Wii U. But there's a quick tip for anyone in these countries affected. You can circumvent this if you change the region settings in your Switch or not Switch, 3DS or and Wii U from your current location to the US. Granted, you're not geo-blocked from using that as a territory. Yeah. So that's a quick tip.
Well, it's not until July, though, so get your virtual console and digital downloads while you still can.
I mean, you can, but the selection is also limited compared to the full eShops.
True.
Yeah.
Next story.
Yes.
Deadly Premonition 2, A Blessing in Disguise, launches on July 10th. This is from Sal Romano over at Gamatsu. So it'll launch both physically and digitally for Switch on July 10th for $49.99. Publisher Rising Star Games and developer Toy Box Games announced. There's an overview. It's both the prequel and the sequel. This is kind of stuff that we already knew.
Yep.
Open-ended adventure, mini-games, bowling, Bayou Rise, skateboard challenge. Oh my god.
This is a jam-packed game.
More. Customization, customize your character and upgrade your skateboard for improved speed and landing more difficult tricks. And there's a new trailer. I've been trying to watch Twin Peaks a bit because Deadly Premonition was inspired by it. I like it so far. And then I just got Deadly Premonition because when this was announced, they made Deadly Premonition Origins half off on Switch, so it's only $15.
Yeah, it's currently on sale, right?
Yeah. Okay. So if you have any interest, I'd suggest get anyone a good deal. Get that version.
I mean, I'll think about it.
Especially because if this one is on Switch, I always say like, well, who knows if like having save data might give you some little bonus thing.
I mean, it's weird enough as a game that I'm not doubting it or discounting it. So.
It gives you a bike.
Or extra skateboard points. Higher Ollie. Something like that.
Yeah, so I'm pretty excited for that. I'm glad it has a release date, and hopefully it won't get delayed or anything. I feel like they're confident enough in announcing a release date that it probably won't. Physical could get delayed. Digital, I doubt it.
Yeah.
But yeah, that'll be cool. Next news story. Final Fantasy XIV patch 5.3 will revamp quest and finally bring in Flying Mouse to a Realm Reborn areas. Square Enix hosted his latest Letter from the Producer live broadcast with new info on Final Fantasy XIV patch 5.3, Reflections in Crystal. Patch 5.3 continues the Shadowbringer storyline and Nier series crossover raid series. That sounded weird. It also brings plenty of quality of life improvements to Realm Reborn areas, including the addition of flying mounts in the 2.x areas. New main scenario quest, the curtains rise for the final act of the Shadowbringers main scenario questline, a Realm Reborn revamp. The main scenario revamp is a big one for new players. The revamp will better streamline the main scenario quest for Realm Reborn. This includes the removal of a number of quests, additional experience points, and gear added to quests.
and more to ensure a smoother journey to Heavensward. It basically makes it much less grindy for new adventurers early in the game. So for those of you who are considering getting into Final Fantasy XIV, I would definitely recommend waiting for patch 5.3.
Is it out already? Wait.
New dungeon.
Wait.
New trial? No, it was delayed recently.
Oh,
it's
not until
July, I think.
Yeah.
I couldn't wait. So I got Heavensward and Shadowbringers because it was on sale on the Square Enix site this past week. And I got my tax refund.
I mean, it sucks because...
And I have friends that play it.
I really want to join you guys, but Square Enix won't let me.
There's got to be a way, because if your brother can do
it...
I
mean, the only way for me to access my account would be to play on PC, but that would...
Is your PC not strong enough?
No, it is strong enough, but with my internet speed, it's going to take forever to download, because there's no...
Oh, yeah, it took me forever to download.
Because there's no pausing the download, so I can't really work around it.
I'm pretty sure there is.
Is there? I should check then.
What if you try just downloading it overnight?
I could, but...
That's what I try to do.
I don't know, man. Stuff happens at night when downloading.
You should try if you can. You should try. You can get on the Ultra server with me, and I think some of the GameSpot guys are on it too.
Yeah, and there's also a free trial for people who have been inactive subscribers for more than 30 days, and you get up to 8 days in playtime.
Yeah, so that's a really good chunk.
Yeah.
Next news story, we got more Final Fantasy VII Remake news, because the Ultimania book, I think, came out.
Yeah, in Japan.
In Japan. So,
is it safe for me to read?
Yoshinori Kitase, he said, "We're not drastically changing the story and making it into something completely different than the original. Even though it's a remake, please assume the story of Final Fantasy VII will continue as Final Fantasy VII always has."
I think they got a bit scared.
Which is kind of weird.
I think they got a bit scared because the reaction has been pretty mixed on the ending. A lot of people are like, "Wait, whoa, what are you doing? Give me the Final Fantasy I'm used to." And another group is saying, "Nomura, you silly, weird bastard. I love you and...
You Kingdom Hearts it."
Yeah, you Kingdom Hearts it. You Norded it. But... Yeah.
So we have this. We have this Silicon Era article. This next thing. Here's what Tetsuya Nomura has to say about the mysterious ending. So he says, "Initially, there was another sentence that we were going to put, but due to various circumstances, we decided to change what it is now. Kitase told me there should be something that connects to what lies beyond the ending." It's just but it says it's one of those Kingdom Hearts things where it says something at the end.
Kind of a tagline to hint at what comes next.
Yeah. And then we have this other story, also from Silicon Era. Final Fantasy VII Remake is part 5 of the Final Fantasy VII compilation, and Nomura talks about the term remake. "We developed the compilation of Final Fantasy VII. The installments included Advent Children, Before Crisis, Crisis Core, and Dirge of Cerberus, so we knew we wanted to make a fifth installment." So he counts this as the fifth installment. Which, with how it ends, I'm not going to spoil anything, but that kind of makes sense.
I've heard tell that
remake has another meaning, and that he cannot answer what that means right now.
No, I was going to say that I've heard tell around the interwebs that the word remake can be taken quite literally after you finish the game. So I'm looking forward to discovering what that means.
It's fun. It's really cool that I see people now playing Crisis Core, and people are playing Dirge of Cerberus.
Oh my god, I'm so sorry for those people.
Ben Janka from GameSpot, he played Crisis Core, and then he played Dirge of Cerberus, it seems like he liked Dirge of Cerberus okay.
Really? Man.
Yeah.
I was expecting some whiplash.
Maybe I'll talk to him about it. I haven't played that one. I've played quite a bit of Crisis Core. My friend Bree, a Twitch streamer, she decided to play Crisis. She's actually streaming Crisis Core.
Yeah, I saw it on Twitch. That's really cool. I actually did play Dirge of Cerberus. It's definitely a game. It's
a game.
That's all I can say. It has some interesting tidbits connecting it to the larger Final Fantasy VII story, and it ends with something that is until this day still unresolved, and I don't know what to make of it.
Ah. Well, what if they remake it as like a part where you play as Vincent?
I mean, it's pretty doable since the remake has such an action oriented bend to the gameplay.
Yeah.
So I don't discount that approach, but it's, if you've played Crisis Core and then play Dirge of Cerberus, the ending will leave you baffled. That's all I'll say.
Also, Advent Children seems to be getting a lot more love now. I always had the impression that a lot of people hated it, but like now I see people coming out being like, yeah, y'all hated on Advent Children way too hard, and I'm like, where were you people? Where have you all been?
I never got the dislike for Advent Children because Cloud's character is not that different, or at least as I see him in the remake, he's much more in line with how he was portrayed in Advent Children. Original game had him emote in a way that you couldn't see his expressions, so you had to fill in the blanks with your imagination.
Yeah.
So I'm guessing that's where the disconnect happened, because now you're seeing him as a quote-unquote real human being emoting and relaying the story to you as the audience, and it's not what you're expecting.
You know what's funny is, like, Advent Children was actually kind of not my first exposure to Final Fantasy VII, because my best friend in high school was playing it one summer, but I was kind of just like, whatever. But then, like, I felt like Advent Children was my first real exposure, and seeing Advent Children without knowing that much about Final Fantasy VII, it's a little weird, but it's also, like, a decent anime movie, even though you barely have any context.
Well, if you bought the DVD, the two-disc special edition...
Yeah, I have the Blu-ray. I have the complete edition.
That's cool. Because the DVD had, like, a prelude where they recount the original story.
Yeah, we didn't watch that. This was in college, and we watched it, and we all liked it.
So that's the thing. People discounted that, and that actually helps to set up a lot of the story for Advent Children. And me being me, I did what I usually do. I went on Wikipedia and let the whole plot synopsis for Final Fantasy VII. So I had a very good grasp of who was who and what happened in the story. So I really didn't mind Advent Children.
It's really funny because we didn't know... Because Red 13 only has, like, one line at the end. And if you don't know Red 13 talks, that's like a, wait, that thing can talk?
Yeah.
I need to rewatch it.
Yeah, same.
You know what I also rewatched? That one fight scene, that really cool fight scene from Crisis Core with Genesis, Sephiroth, and Angeal.
Yeah, that's a good scene.
It's so good. That's why I still rewatch it. Hasn't aged too badly either. Like, I mean, okay, it's a PSP game, so graphically it doesn't look amazing, but it doesn't look...
They weren't aiming for photorealism. It's definitely a bit stylized in the way Square Enix...
Looks kind of like it could fit an Advent Children.
Yeah, probably. Like, Square Enix is pretty good with the later games in their canon. Like, the PlayStation 1 era and earlier... is a bit hit or miss, but everything that came after it's pretty, it holds up pretty well.
I mean, Final Fantasy 13 still looks
amazing,
really
I'd say. Yeah.
Visually. Yeah. Alright, anyways, enough gushing about that. Pokemon Sword and we're gonna have our In From Japan watch along of Advent Children. No, I'm just kidding.
Hey, don't tempt me, man.
We don't have enough fans or a Discord for that yet. This is from, once again, Jenny Lotto over Silicon Era. Does she just do everything?
Probably.
Pokemon Sword and Shield raid dens get competitive. So new max raid event. Man, I haven't played Pokemon in a while.
I played it last week.
Comes to Pokemon Sword and Shield. A new selection of characters are one that are popular with people who put together teams for tournaments and play for keeps. So these Pokemon include... It doesn't say. Oh, there he goes. Dragapult, Excadrill, Togekiss, Tyranicar.
You made a new evolution.
Oh, God. Tyranitar and Whimsicott. Whimsicott, really? That's a competitive... Huh. Will all be showing up to test you. This means their earlier forms, like Cottonee, Dreepy, Drillbur, Larvitar, and Togepi will be there too. Serebii is also reporting instances of Rotom showing up in both its Heat and Wash forms. So you're going to be fighting, you can be fighting a giant oven or a giant washing machine.
That sounds on point.
So look forward to that. And also the first DLC is still slated for June, so yeah.
Are you looking forward to the DLC?
Yeah, but it's just like I have other things to play right now, and as far as monster collectors go, I'm not gonna lie, I've been a little burnt out.
No, I get it.
But I also have the Monster Crown beta to play. And I haven't played Temtem in a while either, and I should play that now that I...
Yeah, I've been meaning to ask how that's going, because I haven't heard anything beyond the initial hype.
Yeah, I think the initial hype died down a lot after it was first released. I think it'll probably come up again once it's out on other platforms.
Yeah,
because it is PC exclusive.
Okay.
This next, we didn't even decide who's gonna do these ones.
I can do it.
I just did a bunch of Final Fantasy stuff, so yeah, you can take these three.
Okay. Trials of Mana demo disappears from Steam after exploit unlocked full game. Okay. Square Enix, or I should say, who did this? Ian Walker for Kotaku. Square Enix recently announced the temporary removal of its Trials of Mana demo from Steam due to unforeseen circumstances. The company provided no further details, but this news comes hot on the heels of players finding a way to access the full game through the demo without having to pay for it. Square Enix did not immediately return Kotaku's request for comment. Okay.
Whoops.
I mean, this is kind of weird because three Square Enix games so far have had issues with Steam. You had the Final Fantasy...
Wait. Oh.
3 issue? Or was it Chrono Trigger? You have Final Fantasy 12. And now this. So, what is going on?
Well, these demo things happen. Like, you know, with the Final Fantasy VII Remake demo and the...
That is...
Well, that was more just a data
mine.
That
is true.
But then the Yakuza, remember when what was it, Yakuza 6?
But, I mean, in terms of Square Enix having 3 things happen within the span of a month, that's kind of suspect.
It might just be all this work from home stuff and different, you know, like making everything harder to...
Yeah, that's true. That's true. You're right.
Like, because if you send something, like, certain files, and you have to do specific things, and you have to send it a certain way so it doesn't get leaked another way, and, you know,
that's
all this
true.
Other stuff.
Okay. Next up, you have Game Pass now has 10 million subscribers by Ethan... By Ethan Gatch for Kotaku. Xbox boss Phil Spencer announced the stat in a new blog post outlining the downloadable game service's continued growth. That's up from 9.5 million monthly users last year. Spencer said subscribers are playing games twice as much since the outbreak of the COVID-19 pandemic, which is really surprising and impressive. I mean, Game Pass has such a good offering of games that it's kind of a no-brainer that a lot of people are diving into that. Our buddy Nate from last week, our guest, also just got a Xbox, and he's probably also enjoying his Game Pass selection. All right. Next up, we have Square Enix gives gamers more reasons to stay at home and play. This is by the Square Enix team on their Square Enix blog website. Okay, it's kind of a longer thing, so I'll just do the first paragraph. To gamers everywhere, in March, as the world was disrupted by the coronavirus crisis, we were warmed by the stories of communities banding together to support those in need. In response, Square Enix introduced a campaign called Stay at Home and Play as our way to reward our loyal gamers for staying home and practicing social distancing. We kicked off our campaign by giving away Tomb Raider 2013 and Lara Croft and the Temple of Osiris for free on Steam. Since then, we have continued to share other free titles, and to date, gamers have downloaded nearly 15 million copies of our games. But we're not stopping here, or there, I should say there. We promise to create more opportunities to download games from our portfolio and only ask one thing in return. Please continue to stay home and play, stay safe, and follow your local guidelines. It delves into more of them doing this kind of stuff and supporting local charities, I guess.
Yeah, so that means they might do more free games in the future, I'm guessing.
Yeah, that's true. I'm hoping they'll dive into the Final Fantasy catalog and give some of the older games away, or Chrono Trigger, or I don't know.
Man, I just bought
that. Which one? Chrono Trigger? Oh.
Yeah.
It's actually...
Well, not just. It was like a month ago, but still.
Oh, yeah. We're going to dive into those sales later. So, yeah. You can read the full article on Square Enix's website.
Okay. Yeah. So...
Our main topic of the week is...
Yeah. Main topic.
Is the Golden Week sales, or I should say the various Golden Week sales. But before we start off, I think we should kind of define what Golden Week is. It's...
First our sponsor, Golden Week. No, I'm just kidding.
It's a week of national holidays in Japan, starting from the 29th of April until... the 5th of May for this year. So you have Showa Day on the 29th of April, Constitution Memorial Day on the 3rd of May, Citizens Holiday, oh no, that was the old one, Greenery Day is the present one on the 4th of May, and Children's Day on the 5th of May. And it's kind of a week of holidays to help businesses and for families to be together. So
yeah, because it's like, it's kind of like there are so many holidays in this one week, let's just take the whole week off,
more or less. If you've played any of the Persona games, you're sure to run into Golden Week sooner or later. So yeah, that's that. And a lot of the digital storefronts are having big Japan-only sales, or I should say, games from Japan are on sale.
Yes.
Which one do you want to cover?
So, I just want to go down the list real quick and just say, like, okay, so PlayStation Store has a big in Japan sale until May 8th. Humble has the Golden Week sale. So, the big in Japan sale, I think I got something from it. But I think that's how I got Monster Hunter. The Humble sale, which I don't know how long it's until.
It's,
let me see.
It's still. Let's see. It's 3 days left.
It's until May 4th. And they have RPG. So I got RPG Maker MV. If you want to start making your own RPG, it is 70% off.
It's on for $20. That is bucks now.
Yeah, that is an $80 value.
Yeah.
And then there is the Final Fantasy franchise sale on GMG, but there is also the... Oh, it's a Square Enix sale with the Final Fantasy franchise. But they're also on sale on Steam.
Yeah, so...
Which sucks, because I just got Final Fantasy 13 like a week and a half
ago. Most of these titles are cross-pollinated, I should say. You can find them on pretty much any digital storefront. So, yeah.
And then there's the Xbox Golden Week sale, and then Nintendo has a bunch of third-party publishers doing their Golden Week sales on Switch, like NIS and Capcom.
Capcom was the spring sale.
Okay. So here's the thing.
Yeah.
I got Monster Hunter World. I got Final Fantasy 14. I am thinking about getting Tales of Berseria.
Yeah, I was thinking about that one too.
It's on sale on both PS4 and Steam, but the Steam version is cheaper.
Yeah.
By like $250. Is there a demo on Steam? I had to re-download the demo on PS4 because...
Let me look real quick. I don't think so.
Because I wanted to retry the demo before I decide on getting it.
I mean, you could just retry the PS4 demo.
Yeah, that's what I did. I already have it on the demo on PS4.
Okay.
I just didn't know if there was a demo also on Steam. I'll be using the same controller anyway.
No, there's no demo.
Oh, okay. Well, that's all set then. Is Blue Dragon on sale on Xbox? Let me see. No. What was the thing that was... There was something for $5 that I was going to grab, but I forgot what it was. I think it was something on Steam. It was really tempting. Oh, ETH. ETH.
Wait.
ETH. Oath and Felg... Oath
is
and Felgana.
Is that the 7th?
I don't know which one it is, but it was for PSP.
I mean, you can also get them on Steam, right?
Yeah, that's where I saw it for $5.
Okay.
Final Fantasy 13 is $8 on Steam. Wait, I thought it was less than that. Yeah, so look at the prices, because like some of them are like... Some things will be cheaper than others, and then it'll be like the other. So make sure you check all of them before you decide, just so you can save some money.
A good resource to follow is Wario64 on Twitter or CheapAssGamer.
Yeah.
They compare a lot of the prices
or
post whenever there's a new deal. And sometimes they also round up the various franchise deals, because the digital storefronts don't do that all the time. So yeah, check that out. Let's see.
I'm gonna keep this because since I have that list here of links to all of them, I'm gonna have to look up stuff and check it out.
I should say Nate last week mentioned Castlevania Requiem, and it's on sale for $10 on the PSN store. And that features...
I think it's also on sale on... Is it also on sale on Steam?
No, that's Castlevania Chronicles. That's the older titles. Requiem is not on Steam. Yeah.
Yeah, that's Lords of Shadow.
Yeah.
You know, it is on sale. Several Dragon Quest
games.
I
mean, Lords of Shadow is a pretty good game, I'd say.
I've never played it. I've just heard it's very... it kind of is a... It's that there are elements that rip off Shadow of the Colossus. Although that kind of, that actually makes me more interested.
I wouldn't say rip off. I'd say they incorporated into the game design. It is a character action game with heavy leanings into the God of War school of character action. It has an excellent soundtrack, and I'd play it for that alone. But check if you can get the full or complete edition, because the main campaign or the story is not finished neatly, I'd say, because you have to have the DLC for some of the plot to make sense, and that really annoys me when I had it on Xbox 360. Be wary of that.
I keep forgetting that the first Ni No Kuni is on PC now.
Yeah, that's the remastered one. It's remastered on PS4 and PC, while the Switch has a port of the old PS3 edition.
Although, the nice thing is there's no exclusive
content. Yeah, that's true.
So you're not really... It's literally just your graphical preference.
The Virtue Last Reward Bundle is also on sale for Steam.
Right. Zero Escape Bundle.
It's for...
A lot of my favorite games are on sale. Metal Gear Rising Revengeance. I don't know if that's in the Golden Week sale, but it's on sale.
Yeah, it's for Xbox, I think.
Dragon Quest. Some Dragon Quest games are on sale. Not 11S, unfortunately, because that's Switch exclusive, but Vanilla 11 and Dragon Quest Heroes and Dragon Quest Builders.
I'm kind of torn. Should I just dive into Dragon Quest 11 on PS4, or should I...
No.
Is this Switch exclusive content that good?
There's a lot. There's just so much they put in that they...
Oh, no.
That it's just better to get 11S.
The music is better. Never mind.
Yeah, that too. Never also mind. That. And also, do you have the demo on your Switch? Yeah. So you already have save data for it, too.
Fine. So. You won me over.
There you go. Playing Dragon Quest VIII has really made me want to replay Dragon Quest XI, and I need to do it because I haven't played 11S.
You haven't?
At some point. I also, I've played 11, the PS4 one. I have 11S. I just haven't played it yet. I also recently just, because before I would have my Switch in my bed with me in handheld mode, and that's how I'd play Animal Crossing. And I'm like, this is ridiculous, because I'd play for too long and stay in bed until, like, whatever time. So I decided to keep my Switch in the dock, which motivates me to get out of bed and play Animal Crossing on the TV, which is actually really nice.
That is true. But I'd say handheld is my preferred way to play it.
It depends on what I'm playing and how much attention, how much I need to be paying attention to the game. Animal Crossing, I don't have to as much, so I could do either. But because I'm doing I'm only doing like an hour or so a day of it, it's just like kind of whatever. Yeah, so if I'm playing something turn-based or something just kind of not that intense, I'll do handheld mode and I'll watch a show I don't have to pay that much attention to, like a animated sitcom or something.
Yeah. I should also mention the Final Fantasy series is also on sale on iOS and Android, and Chrono Trigger is also on sale for $5 on Android and iOS. So,
yeah, didn't the people at MinMax say the mobile version is the way you probably want to play?
Yeah, but I'd say you can also...
But then Ben Hansen was on Kind of Funny, and he said the PC version is great,
yeah, the PC
too,
version is the updated version that is also on mobile. So it's pretty on par in terms of quality. So,
yeah.
Whichever is your preferred method of playing, choose that route. It's cheaper on Android and iOS, so if you want to save $1, use that.
I kind of wish that was on Switch, too.
Yeah. Here's to hoping that Square Enix listens to us. Or maybe they'll port it to the SNES Classic service.
Yeah, maybe they'll port it, and maybe they'll announce that they're remaking it with the Dragon Quest XI engine, because that would be amazing.
I'd much rather have it in the Octopath Traveler engine.
Oh.
Yeah.
Huh.
I mean, the Akira Toriyama artwork works really well in Dragon Quest XI, so it...
Yeah, that's why I think...
It might as well, but...
It would work better.
Some people prefer that nostalgia of the 2D sprite work.
Yeah.
So. Who's to say? But
but then I feel like there's no point in remaking it in that, like, it's not like, I don't know, I feel like it's p-
putting Chrono Trigger specifically in that instead of just porting it?
The Octopath Traveler engine isn't just a one-to-one port because there are new lighting and particle effects. And you can...
But I mean, like, I just feel like Chrono Trigger would do better if it... It would be better if it did a new thing. Like, the when everybody says, oh, they should remake Final Fantasy VI and the Octopath Traveler art style, I'm like, yeah, okay. Like, that makes sense to me. But with Chrono Trigger, I think putting it in a Dragon Quest XI art, like, graphical style makes more sense to me, maybe because of Akira Toriyama.
Yeah,
I don't know.
That's what I'm wondering. Why does that make sense to you? Because they're both 2D RPGs.
I don't know. I don't know, okay? I'm guessing it's because of Kirito.
I'm guessing that too, because to me, they're both 2D RPGs and they'd work fine in either approach. I mean, if
okay, just give me Frog in HD, however
I mean,
you want to do
if
it.
If you want to, reserve some resources and not go all out in the remake route, I'm guessing the Octopath treatment would be better. But if you have resources to spare, then a full on remake would do well for.
Yeah, if you want to do a full
though,
remake,
I would say a remake would be better suited to Chrono Cross because that's already in 3D. That game doesn't get the love it deserves, so it getting a remake treatment would go a long way, I'd say.
Has that one been ported?
No, it's never been ported at all. It's stuck on the PSN store for PS1, Vita, and PSP.
Well, that's a
PS3, Vita, and PSP. It did get ported somewhere.
I mean, I have it on my PlayStation Vita TV, so I can't.
No, but it it never got like a PC port or anything like that.
So that Vagrant Story. Not Xenoblade. The Xenogears is also stuck there. Wild Arms is also stuck there. Breath of Fire 3 and 4 is also stuck there.
No, I'm pretty sure. Isn't there a Wild Arms game on PS4 now?
That's Wild Arms 3. But the older ones aren't on PS4.
No.
Yeah. Huh. Anyway, anything else you're looking forward to out of the Golden Week sale?
I've never played that game.
Which one?
What?
What game have you had?
No, I said, when are they going to port Death Junior?
Oh. I don't know. I mean...
The PSP game? It's just a PSP game I remember from early PSP.
That is also very niche. But I asked, anything else you're looking forward to out of the Golden Week sale? Anything you're thinking of getting? Because, like... Trails of Cold Steel and Trails in the Sky is also on sale. I mean, you could get that.
I need to play that. Finish that demo of 3. Oh, Remember Me is $6. That is a game that needs a. I wish we get rebooted.
I mean, Don't Nod is pretty in demand in the adventure visual novel genre, so. I don't think they'll have any free time.
Yeah, so if they remade it to be more like that, I wonder.
Nah, who knows. Anyway, do you have any picks for the audience? Like anything you, if you had
Zero Escape,
like
if
you had one game to recommend.
Oh God! Don't do this to me. 999 is kind of niche. I have a. Here's my list, and it just this is a cartoon list that rolls out forever. Ni no Kuni, 999. Dragon Quest Builders 2. World of Final Fantasy. Yeah.
The vanilla one or the Maxima one?
Metal Gear Rising, it is on sale on Steam too. World of Final Fantasy Maxima, or you could do you can always do the vanilla one and then just get the Maxima.
Yeah, that is true.
If you like,
do you have to beat the vanilla one to unlock the Maxima content?
I believe so.
Okay. Okay.
Final Fantasy 14. I don't know if that's on sale on
Steam. I think it is. Not anymore. It was on sale till yesterday on the Square Enix site.
Okay. Yeah, that's how I got it. It's not on sale on Steam. No. Okay. I forgot I randomly have Dead Rising 4 because of our buddy somebody from Parallax.
I mean, all the Resident Evil games are also on sale, or most of them are on sale.
A couple of Tales games, Symphonia, Dysteria, and Berseria.
Avoid Dysteria, that's my advice.
Really? But I see a lot of people who love Dysteria.
Don't.
I don't want it. I want Berseria because of the characters. I don't want Dysteria.
Don't feel any temptation towards Dysteria.
I heard the anime makes the story better, so I don't know.
Yeah, if you're really dying to taste the story, just watch the anime. The game is...
Okami's on sale on Steam. Puyo Puyo Tetris. Yakuza Kiwami. God Eater 3. What is the reception? How do people feel about Final Fantasy 13-2?
13-2 is... a game that improves a lot on 13. There's a lot more open-ended exploration. It's still a bit on the linear end, but there's more open-ended exploration. The battle system is sped up a bit, so when you do the paradigm shift, you don't have that delay from one paradigm to the other. Because in the original game in 13, when you did a paradigm shift, and you had that delay, you were vulnerable to enemy attacks. So it being sped up is such a godsend.
I've only heard people talking about 13 recently, but not 13.2.
The thing about 13.2 is it has time travel in its plot. So people have compared it to a modern Chrono Trigger. It is what it is. It's a decent plot, not the greatest, but it's a decent plot.
Morphogenetic fields. And...
No morphogenetic fields. Thank the Lord.
Not like that. not that kind of time travel.
It's more straightforward time travel. Like, go into the past to prevent something from happening.
Isn't Lightning Returns in like the future?
Yeah.
I remember playing the demo, and it was like
Lightning Returns is set in the future.
Or something. Yeah, which that's a completely different game. Way different. I played the demo for that.
I've actually never played that one.
I think it has a demo on
Steam
somewhere.
Yeah,
wherever I played it. It's not Castlevania. Well, it is basically Castlevania. Bloodstained: Curse of the Moon is on sale on Steam for $5.
Yeah. Let's see.
Type Zero, Final Fantasy Type Zero. I don't even know.
It is enjoyable. It's really different. What can I compare it to? Trials of Cold Steel or Trails of Cold Steel. That's what I'd compare it to. It has a high school setting, so. No, it's not exactly Persona. It's an action RPG, but it also feels kind of dated because it was originally a PSP game. It kind of shows
Naruto Boruto Shinobi Striker is $10.
Yeah, but that's a multiplayer only game, so
81% off. Yeah, but it's also the only one where you can make your own customizable Naruto.
Sure,
character.
But how much is that worth, really?
According to one of my best friends who she really loves Naruto, she probably really wants... Actually, I should probably message her and say that right now. Yeah.
The Yakuza games are also on sale, so you can check those out. The Valkyria Chronicle games. Not Revolution.
I actually gifted her, because she's been using... Or she's been trying to use her laptop more. And she wants to finish her building her desktop, which she's just been putting off.
Mm-hmm.
But now that she, like, has access to Steam and stuff, she's like, yeah, I really need to build that. So I gifted her Abzu because she really likes ocean
That's
stuff.
That's cool.
And she got Greece? How do you pronounce? You know what indie game I'm
the
talking about.
The artsy Gris? Indie game.
Yes, the artsy indie game that won all the awards.
I think we have a pretty decent spread of games we recommended.
Yeah.
I'm
gonna have to look.
Just
at
follow
all these.
The links on the various digital storefronts. I think we'll have links in the description.
Of course, if you need to save money, save your money. We're not suggesting you buy if you're bored. If you've been bored and been waiting for sales and like I'll be like, check out your if you have wish lists on like Steam and stuff, there might be some stuff on sale finally that you've been waiting for.
Okay.
Some good discounts.
If I could recommend something, you're as pretty much the rest of the world stuck on the inside, and you're looking for something fun and meaty, I'd suggest Tales of Vesperia because it has multiplayer. So you can play with your partner, your siblings, or even with your parents.
But no online co-op.
No online co-op. So couch co-op, which is really fun.
Yeah.
That's
not an option for me, unfortunately.
I mean, you can.
I don't think my 2-year-old nephew.
I mean,
has
you have your brother and your sister-in-law.
Hand-eye coordination.
Yeah, but they're not into. My two brothers and my sister-in-law aren't into games.
Anyway. If you have someone that's into games and is also stuck with you in the same domicile, you can try that.
Domicile, that's a word.
so that's my pick, I'd say. And you can definitely not go wrong with any of the Final Fantasy games.
Yeah, like I said, I already said all the stuff that... I mean, there's probably more stuff that I'm forgetting.
Yeah.
Don't buy Shining Resonance Refrain. It's not very good.
I tried the demo.
Yeah, I said
it's fine. It's very, it's capital J JRPG.
If you got further in it, you would get tired of it very
probably.
Fast.
It's kind of fan servicey also, but a lot of people also like that. So
the turning into the dragon thing is cool, but there are other games that I think probably do it better.
Yeah. But hey, if you're so inclined to play a bit of that kind of games, or those kind of games, feel free. We're not going to stop you.
Yeah. It doesn't look like Blue Dragon. Well, these aren't backwards compatible games. Whatever. I'm looking at, like, just to see if Blue Dragon is... Let me see. Blue Dragon was on sale. Oh, no, these are all Dragon Ball Z games. I mean, they're not wrong.
Yeah. You're pretty close.
And no Dragon Quest games are on Xbox, I don't think.
Yeah. But I'm guessing we've covered most, if all, of the relevant games.
There's a demo of Blue Dragon. Well, now I wish I had an Xbox.
There was a demo this whole time.
Anyways, that's about it. So,
I think we covered it all.
Sorry, our main topic
is kind of scattered.
Isn't? Yeah. Somebody didn't finish Final Fantasy VII Remake yet.
But also, it's just been a weird news week for main topics. Next week, we may have a guest on, hopefully.
And also, I'm thinking our main topic will probably be whatever Xbox reveals that earlier that day.
Yeah.
Unless something else big happens before that.
Probably.
Or it's either going to be that, or depending on who our guest is, if we can get them.
Yeah, so fingers crossed.
All right, so we have no outro usually. We just wing
it. We're signing off.
Wing it like Jeff Winger.
Signing off. Until next time, folks. Bye.
Yep.